Okay, so this is my next intractable pain video. I want to thank everybody for the support that I'm getting for my my first video, and for the support from Pain News Network, Pat Anson, for putting my article, my story out there. You can actually go and read my entire story and watch my first video by going to www.painnewsnetwork.org, and my story is there. It's called Living with Intractable Pain, and yeah, I was in pretty bad shape that day, so I had to get my story out there, and I'm tired of the fight. I want to really thank everyone who has responded and commented, and especially Brenna. I will be calling you soon. I just wanted to make this video first. Brenna, I know that you're going through a lot and you need help, and you don't know where to turn, as many of us don't. Most pain patients, unfortunately, are intimidated or embarrassed, or they feel like everybody's looking at them like they're some drug seeker, they're some drug addict or whatever, because they need pain medication so bad and they're always in pain. You feel uncomfortable talking about it with your family members or your friends. You know, you can't sit there and just say, I'm in a lot of pain. My back hurts really bad. My pelvic hurts really bad. My leg hurts really bad. My shoulder hurts really bad. My hand hurts really bad. My wrist is killing me. I've got a headache. Everything hurts. You can't do that all the time. It's a bummer to people. And eventually people start thinking, God, you're so dramatic or whatever. But the reality is that these things are real and true and incredibly painful. And if you were going through it, believe me, you would be complaining all the time too. And you would have the same problems we have when we're in intractable pain, with doctors rolling their eyes at us, or people not acknowledging our pain, or dismissing it as if it's something minor, or, you know, sick of hearing about it. There, you know, there are some who have family members who are just sick of hearing about the pain all the time. You know, you're such a bummer. But we live it, and you don't. And so we're sorry that we tell you our pain. We shut up sometimes because why tell you? You're just going to get upset. And that's pretty sad that we have to live that way. We should be able to speak our mind. We should be able to tell you, hey, we're in so much pain, we're just barely hanging on here, and we need help. So I'm really happy to say that I did get published on Pain News Network. My story did get published. My first video got published on Pain News Network and on their Facebook page. And hopefully this will get the message out to more people. We need to join together. Pain patients unite together. Intractable pain is important. People dismiss people in intractable pain as if they're being babies or something, because they're in a constant pain that won't go away no matter what treatment you try, or non-narcotic medication, or whatever you try, nothing works. But the opioid pain medication does. And oh my God, that's such a sin or a crime. No, that is what that medication was made for to begin with. It is a legitimate practice. Even the CDC states that pain medication and treatment with opioid pain medication is a legitimate practice for legitimate reasons. These are legitimate reasons. Now, the people who are out there abusing them, shame on you. We are suffering because of your abuse. We're suffering here because you have gone out and done illegal things. You've gone out and got synthetic forms of these drugs, making hospitals and doctors and everybody think that prescriptions are evil now, that people are overdosing on prescriptions. But in reality, they're a derivative. They're a synthetic form that is remanufactured by the illegal drug dealers and made to look exactly like the actual medication. And people are taking them, and then they are, you know, saying, oh, they overdosed on this pain medication. Even those of you, and I know it's hard, who have pain and have a prescription but are being underdosed, you cannot go get this on the street if you're going to win this fight. You cannot go to these illegal places and get this medication. What we need to do is fight to make this the legitimate practice it's supposed to be, to make it so our doctors can prescribe the amount we need legally and monitor us so that we are okay, that we don't overdose. We have to take it as prescribed. Now, a lot of us suffer because we're underprescribed. This is true. This is why we have to fight to change that. So we need to get together, all of us, and fight for the right to have the proper amount of pain medication. No more, no less. Just what we need to function and have a quality of life like every human being should have. It isn't fair for us to suffer. It isn't fair at all that people are abusing these and making us suffer because of it. Now, at this point in time, I'm having an okay time at the moment because I'm on my pain medication, and I'm doing this recording early enough to where it hasn't worn off yet. So I'm okay right now. I can function. But when this wears off in a little while, I'm in trouble, you know. I do have enough to take another dosage later, but it doesn't last as long as it says. I'm on a time release, so it's supposed to last 12 hours. It lasts maybe 6. If I'm having a good day for some reason, it'll maybe last for 7 to 8 hours. But most of the time, it's about 6 hours. So the 12-hour time release should really be more of a 6-hour time release, and the dosages should be 4 a day and not 2. And if I could get there, I could do so many things, and I would be perfect. I would be fine. But we're not there, and nobody's going to prescribe that to me, unfortunately. So I have to take this opportunity right now when I'm okay to make this video. And that's really sad, because in a while I'm going to be bedbound. I am sitting on my heating pad. I have purple and you know, reddish blotches all over my back from always being on a heating pad. And I have to do that because the pain is excruciating, especially in my back, my lower back and pelvic area. And so even with the pain medication, I have to lay on my heating pad a lot, and I have to keep it on me to keep the pain down. Sometimes I ice it, but the icing seems to actually make the pain worse. So my heating pad is what I use a lot. And so because of that, I have another condition from, I guess, from having the heat on me so much. And that's kind of sad, but it's true. So I have a really ugly blotchy back and behind area, because it's my lower back mostly that is in the worst severe pain. So anyway, I want to thank you all for responding to my story and my video. And I've gotten some really good responses, and I hope more people get involved here. I hope we can get more people to come and join in one place. I honestly think there are a lot of really great places out there, but we have something that could be really good going on here on painnewsnetwork.org with Pat Anson, a former journalist, or journalist actually, but formerly a journalist on in Washington and other places. You can look him up online and find his background. He has been a journalist for a long time, and he has chosen to take this on for pain patients. God bless him. And I think that's wonderful. I think it's a wonderful thing that he's doing for us. And he put out my story. And God, you know, it's horrible that you cannot get a story as severe as mine out there. You can't get anyone to listen. And there's so many people out there like me, not necessarily with broken up bodies from a drunk driving accident. Some people do. Others have other reasons for intractable pain, but there's no cure. They don't have a solution. We've tried everything. You know, they've tried everything. Nothing else works. So they don't have a medical miracle. And God forbid we prescribe opioids to them, because that would be, you know, condoning the use of opioids. And when there's no healing and there's no way out, what difference does it make? Like in my condition, I was hit by a drunk driver over 30 years ago. My condition has worsened with age. I had a vertical shear fracture of my pelvic. It literally broke and split in half, and they viced it back together, and it's crooked. I have photograph of my pelvic on my Facebook page. If you'd like to go look at my Facebook page, I think it's just Laguna Berry, Facebook, whatever, Laguna Berry. Look for Laguna Berry, and you should be able to find me on Facebook. And on top of that, on the Pain News Network Facebook page, now you can find me there as well. My pelvic x-ray was just taken not too long ago here, few months back, and that shows how crooked my pelvic is, and that's only the beginning of my problems. But it has caused me such severe pain to have such a crooked pelvic, and causing a crooked spine and discs and root nerve impingement and scoliosis. And and then, of course, my leg that was amputated is shortened 2 inches, so it's not even correct. And I can't bend the knee that they tried to save. They tried some experimental stuff on me when I had my crash, and it didn't go through and didn't work. So I have I now have it plated with a bolt through it, and that's where it stays. And it's shorter and it doesn't work, so I have to have special prosthetics, not even normal prosthetics made for me. I'm not like any other amputee out there at all that I know of. And so I walk very crooked. I walk with a cane because I want to be strong, and I'm stubborn. I do not want to go into a wheelchair yet. I do not want to be at the point where I'm having to always have, you know, people doing everything for me all the time. But the only way for me to be able to live a quality of life where I can do things on my own mostly, I mean, I'll always need some help, but the only way that I'm going to be able to do things is to have my pain medication given to me without scrutiny, without being called or thought of as an addict. It's horrible to be in this kind of pain. This kind of pain is torture, and it is inhumane. And you taking away pain medications or limiting pain medications from people like me is really against human rights. It's a violation of human rights to make a person suffer like this. Now, if you added cancer at the end of my diagnoses. I say diagnoses because there are so many of them. But if you add cancer at the end or terminal at the end, which I am terminal, I will be this way until I die. So it's sort of terminal. I probably would have no problem. But because I'm just intractable pain, and I should be under palliative care, but the system doesn't see it that way. Apparently, they confuse palliative care with hospice care. Now, I don't want to be in a hospice facility. I don't want to be under that. I want to have the freedoms that every American should enjoy and be able to do things. But the only way I can do that is if I am prescribed the correct amount of opioid medication to reduce my pain enough to where I can do things without being in excruciating pain. I do little things, and when I get my pain medication, yeah, I will do little things, and then it won't take very long before even the pain medication doesn't work and I'm hurting so bad because I'm doing something. But I keep going the best I can, and it does help. If I were able to, you know, take the pain medication the way it should be for a day, and for the breakthrough pain the other 6 a day of the lower dosage, I would be able to do so many things. Go back to school, work, maybe even. I don't know. I had to quit working because the pain was so bad and I was so fatigued trying to get up every day, taking hours just to try to motivate myself to move because it was so painful. When I wake up, it's just, I'm in so much pain, right? First thing in the morning is the worst for me anyway. And probably everybody who has pain medication or pain like me, the worst is the morning. Now you take medications to sleep and you still wake up with that, like I told you before. It's horrible, horrible way to live. So what I'm asking again, okay? Let's unite together. Let's get all the pain patients on Pain News Network together. Tell your story. I'm trying to get an audience with the CDC, with my medical board, my governor, my state representative, the president of the United States, and news media outlets. I have actually contacted investigative reports. I have I'm contacting everybody I can because I'm not going to stop. I'm fighting for all of us, and I need your help. I do. I will do this on my own if I have to, but I need your help. I need more people to speak out about their pain, about how long they've had their pain, how much pain they're in all the time, what's causing their pain, how the doctors can't help, the communication barriers between doctors and hospitals, and how every doctor has different opinions, and it's just a crazy world in the medical world. And this judgment thing that we have going on against people who need opioid pain medication. We are not the overdosers. 30 plus years and I have never overdosed once. I've never even come close. I haven't even felt high from my pain medication. It only alleviates my pain, and that's it. That's because I really have pain. So, you know, if you have a pain scale of 50, let's say, not using the table they use at the doctor's office, but let's say you have a pain scale of 50, you're gonna need opioids that control a pain scale of 50. If you have a pain scale of 100, you're gonna need opioids that will control a pain scale of 100, etc. You will need more the more pain you're in. Now, I'm not condoning anyone who's abusing opioid medication or taking it for a high or whatever reason that they're taking it and taking too much and not being under a doctor's care. I'm not condoning that at all. I'm saying we need to be under our doctor's care, and our doctors need to feel free to care for us as physicians and allow us to have whatever it takes to level our pain out without being under scrutiny by the CDC, the DEA, the medical boards. They need to feel free to make their own judgment. They went to school. They know what they're doing. We're not like, I don't want to bring up names, but these rock stars and movie stars who pay these physicians to give them all these medications and they overdose and die or whatever. We're normal people. We don't have that kind of money to pay these physicians off. They're doing this under their own medical judgment, but they stopped giving us pain medication under the new guidelines of the CDC, under fear of being prosecuted. And that is totally wrong. When a doctor really thinks you need pain medication but can't give it to you because of fear, he's not able to do his job properly. And that's not right. If a doctor says this person can handle this much medication, then you should listen to him or her. If a doctor says this patient is going to be in pain for the rest of their life and they deserve a quality of life without pain, you should listen to them. They know. And the ones who don't know need to be trained in things like intractable pain. So I guess what I'm saying is we need more education and we need to be seen more. This is my next video here on intractable pain, and I'm going to keep going and going and going as long as I can bear it until I'm seen, until somebody listens, until this stops, because it isn't right to torture a human being. It isn't right to make a person stay in pain for no reason at all, other than statistics show that people are overdosing. When a person was on that medication and never overdosed. So you have no ground to walk on there or to stand on there with that. I've never overdosed. I was on twice as much medication as I am now, and I never overdosed, and I was fine. Sometimes I didn't even take it all. I just would like it prescribed that way, so on my bad days, I'm allowed to take as much as I need, and on my good days, I don't need to take it all. This limitation thing is ridiculous for people like me. You can't fix me. There's no fixing me. This is me and my life forever, for the rest of my life. I will be in intractable pain beyond anything you could imagine. I will always have pain, and it will get worse as I get older. That's just a fact. So, all you pain patients out there, hang in there. Join this fight with me. Go read my story on painnewsnetwork.org. Go read it. Check out the information. Most people, I've had somebody tell me they didn't even know what intractable pain was. And that's sad. They have intractable pain and they didn't even know what it is, because the doctors don't know what it is, because the CDC doesn't acknowledge what it is. Nobody wants to face what this is, and it's real. And we need to start facing intractable pain disease. Many people have it. It isn't chronic pain. It isn't acute pain. It's intractable. It never goes away. It cannot be fixed. There is no operation. There is no cure. It's just pain all the time, and it's torture. So let's join together, and let's fight this. Let's fight these decisions that are being made for us. Let's fight this and make this something that people are aware of, because people are not aware of intractable pain disease, or people like me and our conditions. They don't know. So as far as they know, we're nobody, or we're just these people that are overdosing. They don't know about conditions like mine or others who have intractable pain for other reasons. They don't know. So we have to let them know. We've got to get out there, become a whole united organization of pain patients, so that they can see this is not curable and we need help. And we cannot live in this kind of pain. We could die from it. And that is wrong. And it should be illegal. So contact me. Let me know what you think, if you're willing to fight with me. I'm going to continue to contact media, CDC, president, everybody that I have to get something done. Thank you guys for listening. Brenna, I will be calling you shortly, dear. Okay? And God bless you all. And let's stop this torture. We are victims. We are not the problem. We're not the illegal drug users. We're victims of pain. God bless you. Have a great day. And I'll see you on my next video.